Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. Our program will begin in 5 minutes.
Você disser que eu desafino amor, saiba que isto em mim provoca imensa dor. Só privilegiados têm ouvido igual ao seu. Eu possuo apenas o que Deus me deu. Se você insiste em classificar meu comportamento de antimusical, eu mesmo mentindo devo argumentar que isto é bossa nova, que isto é muito natural. O que você não sabe, nem sequer pressente, é que os desafinados também têm coração. Fotografei você na minha Rolleiflex, revelou-se a sua enorme ingratidão. Só não poderá falar assim do meu amor, ele é o maior que você pode encontrar, viu? Você com a sua música esqueceu o principal, que no peito dos desafinados, no fundo do peito bate calado. No peito dos desafinados também bate um coração. Thank you.
Hello again. Thanks for being such a great audience and making it back for this afternoon's panel session discussing AI and ML and cyber look to the future. I want to remind everybody that if you have questions for the panel, once we get to the Q&A session, please take a moment to jot those down legibly, please, on the notepads in front of you, and we'll have runners picking those up and handing them to the moderator. So I'd like to bring out Cadet Third Class Whitney Addison to introduce our panel moderator for this afternoon. Thanks.
Good afternoon. My name is Cadet Third Class Addison Whitney, and I'll be introducing today's speaker. He graduated from the United States Air Force Academy in 1972. After that, he went on to spend 32 years of distinguished service in the United States Air Force, retiring at the rank of Major General and the commander of the Air Force Research Laboratory at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, Ohio. He continues to serve to this day as director and CEO of the Software Engineering Institute at Carnegie Mellon University, an organization dedicated to areas central to the Department of Defense's mission, and an organization that provides direct support to more than 50 government entities. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for Dr. Paul Nielsen.
Thank you.
You got bright light, huh?
Yeah.
Well, good afternoon. 72, that's a long time ago. I think the only person in this room older than me is Harry. But he's not much older. We're the same vintage, really. We're the same vintage. Well, good afternoon, and welcome to our panel this afternoon on AI, ML, and cyber. A look to the future. That's a broad topic, so we can say whatever we want, right? It's kind of the broadest topic you could have. I think we have a really great panel for you, and I think it'll be an interesting time. But first, I'd really like to thank AFCEA, the Rocky Mountain chapter of AFCEA that's put on this conference for all these years, for a super symposium. I don't always get here, but I come most of the years, and it's something I really look forward to every year, and I'm sure all of you do too. And I'm looking forward to continuing to come here for the next years, as we heard the nice announcement today. And for all of us who have ever passed through Colorado Springs, what a great city to visit. And what can you say about this hotel? It's a wonderful hotel. So far, in this conference, we've had some really insightful talks, and I've really enjoyed the major talks that have gone on. We had the Bill Marion, Garden Hanna, Nancy Norton, Dennis Vye this morning, and Chris Rice. Each of these, I learn something from every talk I go to all the time. And you can tell I've been to a lot of talks now. And the beat's going to go on tomorrow with General Mike Holmes, General John Shaw, and then in a classified session, General Bob Skinner. So, man, make sure you come back tomorrow to hear these great leaders and what they have to say. When I go to lots of conferences, as many of you do, and I love the speakers, but the speakers actually provide the scaffolding for the rest of the conference, because the energy for a conference really comes from the attendees, the exhibitors, and all that networking that goes on during the intermissions. I've been especially appreciative at this conference that we've had so much time to be able to network in the exhibit hall, and I think the exhibitors appreciate that too. So now let's get to the topic of interest. Man, there is lots of excitement in OSD and throughout the world on the topics of AI and ML, and there's been lots of hype. So we got to fess up to that. We've seen a lot of promise and some great demos and applications, in the early stages of this right now. We have to think, how do AI and ML and autonomy help cyber? And what about the cyber vulnerabilities for AI systems? Some of them the standard ones we've always seen, but there's some new vulnerabilities that are creeping up too. I'm sure we're going to have lots of good discussions about that. Now, we have a great panel here to talk about all the aspects of this topic, and we'll never cover it all, but we'll cover what we can in our opening comments, and then want all of you to be prepared for some great questions, and hopefully we'll have some great answers for those questions. But it's an interesting topic for us all. Cyber has been a hot topic for about 30 years. I think it was 1988 when the Morris worm was loosed on the system, and ever since then, we've been worried about that. Most of us have suffered from this through some cyber leaks and everything. I'm a OMB leaker, and I was a Marriott person that's affected by that leak. You know, and I think I was affected by the Target leak too, although my wife only shopped at Target once in like a year. But there we were, you know. And AI and ML is both new and old. And that's one thing I think is interesting that sometimes people forget. New algorithm development in the early 2000s and the relentless increase in computational power that we've seen over the last 40 years really rejuvenated early work in neural nets and other types of AI that kind of date back to the 70s and 80s and even to the 40s and 50s. I've been at Carnegie Mellon now for about 14 years, following my Air Force career. It's been a lot of fun. It's a great place to work. Geez, you know, when you go to retire, go to work at a university if you can, because it'll keep you young. It'll make you feel old sometimes, but it'll keep you young by all the topics you're exposed to. And Carnegie Mellon is kind of one of the hotbeds of AI and autonomy. Not the only one. There's other great universities too. But it's been exciting for me to be in the midst of that. Carnegie Mellon's work in AI started in the 1950s. And that's something to think about. There's a hall at Carnegie Mellon called the Newell Simon Hall. And it was Alan Newman. I got that wrong. I can spell it. Alan Newell. That's right, Newell. Alan Newell and Herb Simon that did some early work in like 1955 and 56 on AI that kind of got some threads of AI started. And and Simon ended up getting the Nobel Prize and the Turing Prize. Newell got the Turing Prize, you know, the big prize for computer science and everything. And now, you know, Carnegie Mellon's work has gone through all the great DARPA challenges of the early 2000s. And just last Friday, the Army established, Future Command established their AI center at Carnegie Mellon. And AFRL's got an embedded scientist and engineer at Carnegie Mellon now to kind of take advantage of the work that's going on there. So I've already mentioned, you know, there's lots of others working in this field, certainly in the academic world. And when you go to the defense industrial base, all the players are starting to look at this. When you go outside of the industrial base, you know, there's the Googles and the Amazons and the Teslas and a whole host of startups that are kind of working in this world. One thing interesting for DoD, since all that work's going on commercially, it's really available to everybody in the world. And that means some of our international competitors have access to a lot of that work too. And we've seen reports of the investments that China's trying to make in this. We know the investments that Russia's trying to make in this. And even some sort of non-peer competitors are trying to take advantage of AI and ML in their work. Nonetheless, there's lots of interesting things to think about in AI and lots of challenges. ML systems can be so very accurate, but at the same time, they can be very fragile. They can be fooled by strategies and noise in the system that would never fool a human. They can be vulnerable to the classic cyber attacks that I mentioned earlier, but they also open up a whole new class of different kind of cyber attacks based on the way they continue to learn and their dependence on data. ML systems are kind of opaque in the way they make decisions. And this is tough for us humans because we don't really know how they're making the decisions they make sometimes. Other issues include the whole idea of correlation versus causation, privacy and ethics, trust, human-machine teaming, and the system engineering and architectural aspects of AI and ML. Despite all these challenges, though, there is all that promise. And man, that's what really intrigues us, the ability to address problems where speed of action, where volumes of data, where danger, persistence, scaling, and cost issues arise. That's what's drawing us to this AI world and what it may be able to do this. Now, I'm an old engineer now, not quite as old as Harry. I'm being too hard on you, Harry, I'm sorry. But I think you could tell from his panel and my panel that we're still young at heart, and we're still interested and intrigued in all the possibilities of this. This is opening up a whole new world to all the engineers of the world, to all the operators of the world, and that's why it's such a big topic now. So now I'm going to introduce our first panelist, and I'm going to introduce the panelists, let them have their say, then introduce the next panelist. So our first panelist, we'll be sitting right next to me, is Dr. Matt Gaston. And Matt's the director of the Emerging Technology Center at Carnegie Mellon University's SCI, so he's one of my colleagues here. As the head of the Emerging Technology Center, he's really been doing lots of work in AI, and he's trained as an AI person, his PhD is in AI. Matt came to us from General Dynamics, and we have another General Dynamics guy on the panel, actually. And before that, he was at NSA as a civilian, and then earlier as a military guy after doing his undergrad in ROTC training at Notre Dame. So Matt, we'll let you have your first say there, okay?
Well, thanks, Paul, and thanks to AFSEA and the Rocky Mountain chapter for having me. It's a great honor to be here with my esteemed colleagues on the panel. I'm really not a cyber person. I know I spent 10 years at the National Security Agency, which maybe makes me a cyber person by default. But I wanted to start by talking specifically about AI and actually follow on to some of the comments we heard during General Radighi's panel earlier today. I have been doing AI, applying AI to defense and national security systems for about 20 years. That was long before it was fashionable, I think. I was telling some folks at lunch that I remember 15 years ago making the Why Machine Learning Matters presentation at the National Security Agency. And they've gone on to do amazing things since then. I did just get back, so I'm here today. I was in Pittsburgh for 2 days before that, and then the week before that I was in Hawaii at the Association for the Advancement of Artificial Intelligence. It's the premier AI conference from an academic perspective. I've been attending that conference on and off for about 20 years. I remember when there was only 300 or 400 folks in attendance. This year there was over 3,000 people in attendance, and nearly that many submitted papers to the conference. Mm-hmm. General Radighi talked a little bit about the sort of arms race that's happening in AI and the balance between US and China and the rest of the world when it comes to AI. I won't offer an opinion about that, but I will give some statistics in the academic world. So I've been following these statistics for years, and they're really pretty interesting. This year at AAAI, which again is the premier AI conference, there were some 7,000, I think, papers submitted for selection. This year, China outpaced everybody. Over 2,400 papers submitted to be accepted to the conference. The U.S. was in second, which is good, about 1,200 papers. So double the number of papers that were produced for AAAI. Maybe on the good news for us, the acceptance rates of those papers was only about 16% for the papers that came from China, and about 21% for the papers that came from the U.S. I'm happy to give these actual numbers to you. They're all over Twitter. You can find them. They're slides. It's actually one of the most interesting points of this conference. So that just gives you a perspective of really where the investments are going, the commitment of nation states to this AI technology that everyone is so excited about. There's also a really good book by Kai-Fu Lee. I hope someone has heard about this book. I think it's called AI Superpowers, and it's really about this balance between the U.S. and China. Mm-hmm. And while I think General Radighi suggested that China may be leading in AI, Kai-Fu Lee suggests that not quite yet. Not quite yet, but there's a couple of interesting aspects to that. First, Kai-Fu Lee breaks AI down into four categories, or what he calls four waves. Internet AI, which is what the Googles and Facebooks and even Amazons are really involved in. Business AI, which is the application of AI to proprietary data within an enterprise, which is a second class. Perception AI, which is the category of AI that is all about sensing, giving AI systems eyes and ears and things like that. Mm-hmm. And then the last wave is autonomous AI, where the system is free to make its own decisions and act in the world, maybe without a human. And Kai-Fu Lee asserts that the U.S. is leading in most of these areas, but the key differentiator is data. And this is where I will give some opinion. This is just Matt's opinion. I worry about data. I worry about data when I look at China. They have different sort of societal norms, different perspectives on civil liberties, and they're willing to collect a lot of data that maybe the U.S. isn't willing to collect and use. The most profound example of this is I read an article where they're instrumenting their workers in factories with helmets that sense brain signals. And they use this data to determine when the workers need a break or need a meal or need a day off. And that all sounds pretty good, wow. Right? Like if I need a break, I would like for the company to know I need a break and a day off. But that data can all be repurposed. And when you start thinking about repurposing that data, that amount of data is going to be really hard for us in the U.S. to collect, where we can understand the brain circuitry and the brain signals that are being sent.
Wow.
And imagine what they can build using AI and machine learning with those technologies. So that's probably the one worry I have pretty concretely about sort of the future of AI and ML. I also thought, if I have enough time, I wanted to share right up front, and you can ask, maybe you can ask a question about these towards the end, three of my key observations about what's going on in AI right now. And these are both worries, but if you get to know me, everything that's a worry is also an opportunity. So I look at them on both sides. The first is that when people say AI, they mean a lot of different things. Different people mean a lot of different things. It's hard to pin down exactly what AI might mean to some of these folks. I will tell you that most of what I hear around the Department of Defense and the national security space is AI means deep learning. And deep learning is a very powerful tool. To Paul's point, it was invented in the 80s or maybe even going back earlier than that. It is a very powerful tool. But there's a lot more to AI.
Yeah.
And just to give you maybe two quick examples, I'm pretty excited about a category of machine learning called reinforcement learning, which is agents learning to operate in the world on their own and all of the policies that allow them to do that. So it's not just a decision, but it's a control, a set of control actions that they can take. And the other is combinatorial optimization. Not to plug CMU too much, but we just had a poker-playing robot named Labradus. The first ever poker playing robot to win No Limit Texas Hold'em. And that was done, there was some deep learning in that system, but it was mostly through this combinatorial optimization technology, which is a whole nother category of AI. My second worry is that we're limited by some of the hype around deep learning in particular. Deep learning is the thing that's getting most of the traction. There are these other techniques, and I'm actually excited. So the opportunity side of this is in the academic community, people are starting to merge what you might call old AI, symbolic AI, with these deep learning systems. And this is going to allow us to move up the reasoning and decision-making levels of the AI hierarchy. And then the last one, which is near and dear to the Software Engineering Institute's core, is AI engineering. In the major rush to get to adopt machine learning, deep learning technologies, we're forgetting that there is a need for an engineering discipline around these systems. Mm-hmm. They present new vulnerabilities. This is where I allude to cyber a little bit. They present new vulnerabilities, new challenges. How do we test them? What does it mean for our acquisition processes? And so I think there's a great demand right now to sort of mature the discipline of AI engineering. And that's something we're working on. We're certainly looking for partners in all of that. The one cyber bit I'll mention, and maybe someone can follow on with a question, there's a lot of buzz in the academic world in adversarial machine learning. And these are some exciting techniques that were actually built to build better machine learning capabilities, but people have flipped them on their head, as they're wont to do, and used them to attack machine learning systems. And so it's pretty well known that for any deep learning application, it's pretty easy to create an adversarial attack against that machine learning system, to fool that machine learning system. I heard it alluded to earlier with these adversarial tags that were put on stop signs or some noise added into an image to get things to classify different ways. This space of adversarial learning is really, really important. We have to pay a lot of attention to it. And I think we need to get at the core of how we build these systems and build security in. And so that's where I get back to the cybersecurity perspective. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Paul.
Wow, thanks, Matt. And thanks for the recent update on the AAAI conference. That's pretty interesting, too. So our next speaker is another Matt, and another Dr. Matt. So we got two Dr. Matts in a row. So we got Dr. Matt McFadden is the Director of Cyber for General Dynamics. And GD has a large cyber presence, really large cyber presence. I think I read over 6,000 professionals, you know, working for the government and other people. It covers this full spectrum of cyber type work. He came to GD with the merger of CSRA, where he had been the chief technologist for the defense division of CSRA. And he's also supported CSRA's work with the Defense Cybercrime Center, which is doing some amazing work for us around the country. And earlier, he started his career at Computer Science Corporation, I think. Is that right?
Good old CSC, so, yep.
Yeah, a lot of C's in there. Go ahead, please.
Awesome. Alrighty, thanks for everyone for inviting me here. And AI is really a kind of a game changer when it comes to cyber. But I really think about you know, at the end of the day, we're really trying to reduce our threat landscape. So, you know, when we look at what the threat landscape entails, I mean, you know, we have customers onboarding to the cloud every single day. We have hybrid cloud, multi-tenancy. We have emerging threats, 0 days, technology is changing. And part of the goal is to really drive more to more of a preventive environment. So, you know, my background, very much incident response, malware analysis, network intrusion, and, you know, part of the great thing that I have with my job is I get to visit a lot of our customers and see how they're doing their cyber operations. And when I look at AI, I think it really comes down to, you know, what outcome are you trying to produce? What problem are you trying to solve? Because it has a very robust application across, you know, the cyber domain. And we all know, you know, the cyber domain is huge. You know, you have everything from risk management to, you know, your endpoints to your perimeter. And, you know, there's very niche places where you can drive that. So when I look at AI application, it's really about detecting a threat and remediating it as quick as possible. So you're kind of shortening, you know, you're really shortening that threat lifecycle. So it's very, very important to actually think about that holistically. So you can do that at a, you know, a very, you know, a few machines or, you know, a very narrow network. But, you know, when you're a very, very large government agency, how do you do that amongst various enclaves, various sensors, various devices, various technologies? It really comes, you know, becomes daunting. So I had the pleasure on Monday to teach a cyber automation course as part of the pre-conference training. Luckily, I had a lot of airmen in there. And, you know, it's we're really trying to drive of how we can begin to take, you know, AI and some of the automation tools that are available and really develop some type of adaptive response. So, you know, when I look at some of the largest, you know, security operation centers that we have, you know, how do you quantify that? Well, you know, the number of sensors, the number of data that we're ingesting, anywhere from, you know, 1,000 to 200,000 endpoints, 1,000 to 200,000 users. At the end of the day, you still have that very finite amount of resources, you know, 10, 20, 30, maybe 50 people looking at that same data day in and day out. So, like, where AI and automation really helps is, you know, it's about really driving your finite resources to be more effective. So, you know, there's the other argument. You know, does everyone think AI is going to replace humans? Any hands up? Yeah, hopefully. I don't think so, but I think there's always going to be some type of, you know, human intervention to help drive how we respond. So, you know, as we, you know, drive towards, you know, the 2019-2020, I see AI having a much bigger play, but really we're kind of somewhat reliant on, you know, what some of the industry providers are doing. So, you know, there's lots of tools out there. I think we need to be more effective with the tools that we have. We have to apply them uniformly. You know, there's been a lack of integration, right? So a lot of the AI vendors, you know, you can apply them across the ecosystem, but you're very kind of tied into their ecosystem, right? So I want to see, you know, cross perimeter defenses, cross endpoint defenses, incorporating threat intel. The other thing is that, you know, sometimes folks say that, you know, AI is the future for detection. Well, you know, the heuristics, the signature-based stuff, I think that is all still valid. It's just kind of using AI to supplement that. So, you know, if I could kind of drive anything with AI, it's all about that layered cyber defense. You know, AI isn't the end-all be-all of your cyber defense. It's a very important component of many other things. You know, if you don't have proper governance or a proper situational awareness, you're going to still have the same challenges even though you have AI. And I think I'll pause there.
Okay, that's great. Maybe we can come back later and talk a little bit about DARPA's cyber challenge and how that went. Okay, the next person on our panel is Anthony Greco. He leads the Trust Strategy Office for Cisco. He has daunting responsibilities when you think about that. Cisco's everywhere. He does security, trust data protection, privacy for Cisco and its customers. He's been at Cisco, he's a young looking guy, for 18 years now. And he started off as an engineer, but one of the great things is he's kind of gone through various parts of the Cisco ecosystem. So he's kind of worked with customers, he's worked on product development, he's worked across the board, which I think really gives him tremendous insights into this whole practice. He also sits on the board of the National Cybersecurity Alliance and participates in many community initiatives in the cyber area. Anthony.
Thank you so much. And thank you all for being here, and I appreciate the opportunity to be here, and also thank you for your service to our country. I have the pleasure today of representing Cisco in the context of a global conversation we're having around trust. And certainly AI and ML play a significant role in where the future is going. But a lot of the conversations that we have around cyber related to AI and ML are really centered around the idea of cyber resilience. We talk about that as a guiding framework for us to have conversations that help drive discussions to outcome-based activities that our customers need to undertake. So we think about resilience, we think about it in terms of proactively understanding risk, where your assets are, what are the risks to those assets, how are you monitoring them, actually monitoring them, and then being ready to respond and indeed remediate when you need to. That full life cycle is something that we speak quite a bit about. In fact, when we look across our customer base, and we've done a survey of 1,000 critical high-value customers in every industry from finance to oil and gas to healthcare to government across the globe, we have seen a real pain point existing where these businesses have embarked upon fundamental, mission-critical, business-changing activities that have been stopped because of cybersecurity concerns. 39% of those 1,000 companies had to stop a mission-critical activity because of cybersecurity concerns. Many of those, not all of them, many of them had a component of AI and ML as a part of the conversation. So when we think about cyber resilience and we think about AI and ML, there's a lot of context going on globally where businesses are attacking and thinking about how they're going to leverage these technologies, but frankly running into a wall when it comes to concerns from a cybersecurity perspective. I'd like to also level set a little bit, a couple of examples where we're deploying ML systems today as a part of cyber defenses, both for ourselves and our customers. One key area for us is our intelligence organization we call Talos, which is the Cisco Threat Intelligence Organization. And indeed, that organization is the one that's responsible for generating and actioning intelligence that results in 20 billion blocks on the internet every day. Every day we stop 20 billion attacks across the internet. And so feeding that system is, as you can imagine, a lot of intelligence and a lot of data. Wow. There is not one piece of intelligence, and in many cases, not one action that's taken to do the actual blocking that isn't in some way related to AI and ML algorithms being deployed, whether it's labeling data, whether it's classification, any sorts of things are done in that environment. But today that is being deployed in really meaningful ways. And indeed, there's a lot of lessons learned out of what we've been doing there. Another place where we've taken on AI and ML as a really key differentiator is in the area of helping secure enterprises. In particular, today, encryption, a very critical component to security and overall security of systems, creates a real challenge for cyber defenders. It creates a blind spot. When you see encrypted traffic going by, do you know if it's good or bad? And indeed, we sat and looked at that problem and looked at the characteristics of AI and ML and created some really innovative things we call encrypted traffic analytics, ETA. And indeed, that's taking that encrypted traffic, not decrypting it, and looking for the signatures and through the algorithm usage and the broad sets of data that we've used to train them, and look for adversarial behavior in that encrypted traffic. And indeed, this is just the beginning of the types of ideas that we think are possible in the domains of cybersecurity when we think about AI and ML. It's not just about defending or detecting either. There's a tremendous amount of excitement that I've got as we talk about zero trust networks and the data and information that's going to be generated from them to apply AI and ML to further the overall cybersecurity resilience of our customers. And it's not just on the operational side. It's also on the development and design side. We're actively right now thinking quite a bit about and are very excited about how AI and ML can transform the notion of secure software development and secure hardware development. And how do we think about supply chain security and risks applying algorithms to data that come into those different domains really will help us think about a next generation of where AI and ML can help us in the cybersecurity domains. And with all of that, there's really three areas that I'd like to highlight that we've observed that are real challenges in this space that a couple of the other panelists both here and elsewhere have talked about, but I think are worth calling out again. Mm-hmm. Data. Data is the key. Clean data. Data that you trust. Mm-hmm. Data that you understand. The notion of trusting that data that's going to be a part of this conversation is, I think, a foundational component that we don't spend enough time talking about. Secondly, the systems are the ones that solve the problems. AI and ML become a part of a system. And so we need to keep in mind that these are tools that need to plug into larger systems that actually are parts of the things that take the action. And finally, as a couple of my colleagues like to joke around the office, magic is not useful. Right? Having a magic AI or ML algorithm that solves some magic problem, but we can't explain why and we have no idea what the result is, and therefore I may or may not have any confidence in what the decisioning is, is really something that we've got to think about. How do we mature capabilities into explainability, inspectability, and ultimately trust of the decisions that are being made? So with that.
Great, great. Thank you so much, Anthony. That tees up a few questions I kind of already got. So thank you for that. So our final panelist is Lieutenant Colonel Mike Chiaramonte. He's an associate professor of computer science at the U.S. Air Force Academy. And he also serves as the director of Air Force CyberWorks. And I've seen him out there in the exhibit hall helping to explain people what CyberWorks is up to. He's a 2001 grad of the Academy. That does make me feel pretty old. And has had a variety of great assignments like we do with all our officers around in comm, computer, networking, and the intel fields. And received his PhD relatively recently in 2008 from Arizona State. So over to you.
Well, thank you very much for having me here today. My colleagues have talked a lot about the technical side of artificial intelligence and machine learning, some of the concerns and advances they're making there, and it's a pretty exciting field to see how that could impact not just what we're doing in the cyberspace domain, but in general across all of our domains of operation. And sitting up at the Air Force Academy, one of our concerns, obviously, is how do I build future Air Force leaders or future military leaders that can operate in that domain in a world where those human-computer teams are much more deep and rich than they are today, where machines are perhaps making decisions that humans are making today. So as we move forward on that, we've spent a lot of time over the last few years revamping and tweaking our cyber curriculum, really looking at how do we make more deep technologists that know how to operate in that technical domain. Now we're looking specifically at how do we also do that in the artificial intelligence domain? And as a computer science faculty member, it's easy for me to say, well, let's teach them to write artificial intelligence algorithms and do the math. And we've done that. We've revamped some of our program to give them a lot more math-heavy AI focus on how to develop those type of technologies. But it's far more than the ones and zeros and the math that sit behind that. They're going to make effective operations in tomorrow's warfighting domain. When you start bringing machines into our warfighting teams as decision makers, the dynamic changes a little bit. It's ethics come into concern. Several of my colleagues here mentioned trust. How do I trust a computer team member? Right now, we've done some experiments where we stick individuals in cars and the automatic parking thing and packs them up into a parking spot. And there's a obvious sense of unease the first time a driver experiences that. They're just not used to a machine doing that for them. And that's a pretty simplistic example of technology starting to take some of that capability away from the human being. What does that look like as we expand that across the operational domain? So trust is a big one. It's also gonna play into what policy and law is gonna reflect and what can we do? How are ROEs written? What does it look like? What is the appropriate level of risk for a machine to take? Can we trust that it's taking the right level of risk? What if it's wrong? So as we look forward and start building second lieutenants for tomorrow's fight, the real question is, what does it look like from a multidisciplinary aspect to create an officer or an enlisted member that knows how to think in that space so that they can effectively advise and understand what that technology is doing, but also know what some of the pitfalls might be, what some of the second, third order effects might be of using that in a joint or coalition environment. So that's where we're moving out today. Luckily, at the Air Force Academy, we have a pretty good foothold for that. We already have a fairly broad multidisciplinary effort going on in the AI fields between the Academy Center for Cyber Research, the Warfighter Effectiveness Research Center, which is really in the Behavioral Science Department with our EE department. So we're really starting to see some of that. That's not just algorithmic development, but how do I do the experiment with human-computer teaming and make sure that we're starting to learn more about those situations. There's still a lot more to go with respect to building that into some of the strategy, law, and policy offerings that take place, and that may not be the appropriate place, whether it be at the Air Force Academy, but somewhere through their officer development, we need to understand that they're going to need to be able to reason on those topics.
So. Great, thanks so much. Okay, so we're going to open it up to questions right now. Please use the mics. It's hard for us to see the questions, so kind of state your name and see the questioners. So state your name and everything so we can sort of look in the right direction to get that. And I guess maybe I'll start with one of the first questions just to get things primed up while you're all thinking about that. And I guess that question might be, we're thinking about the vulnerabilities of AI systems, but as some people have mentioned, we could also use AI in a DevOps environment to help test for cyber vulnerabilities throughout the development cycle, and even to look for other types of software engineering techniques. Because DevOps tries to do automated testing every day. What experience do we have with that among the panel, or what's some of the ideas of using AI in the development cycle for software systems?
Well, I'll start with at least some thoughts of things that we're headed down the path of and are working actively towards. There's a number of different domains that we think about. Obviously, in the DevOps cycle, there's a number of different places where you can insert algorithmically inclined analysis in order to do detection. So there's natural places where we're looking at large code bases and looking across large code bases in order to decipher where we think areas of risk are based off of a number of different factors, many of which include activity and other features that go into the algorithms that we're trialing right now to think about how do we proactively identify places where there's risk. The next thing that we also think about is a part of the testing and natural design cycle that we do. There's a ton of data that's generated as a part of the testing processes themselves. And those haven't been looked at necessarily they typically get looked at either from a did you pass or fail cybersecurity tests, or did you pass or fail functional tests. And when you start looking at this with a much more complex, broader time domain, lots more data, there's a ton of opportunities that are really evolving very rapidly, I think, in the test side of the cycle that we're focused on right now.
Yeah. Any other ideas from the panel about this?
I'll add some. It's not necessarily specific to DevOps, but we've seen some of the research that we've been involved in looking at really higher level code flow rather than the specific lines of code themselves, and trying to evaluate whether or not there are potential vulnerabilities that are unseen based on other, for lack of a better word, genetic lineage of different types of malware or different types of exploitations we've seen in the past. So some of that can be applied in that environment to, I think, give us a little bit of a precursor of how secure we think our software may be. It also could be done after the fact, look at code that's in deployment to see if it's been modified, to see if something may have compromised its code flow from its initial plan state.
I've got a couple questions here that get a little bit at the DARPA Cyber Challenge. So I think I'll ask them now because they kind of come. And it's one says, over the course of the symposium, ML and AI have been focused on the defensive capabilities. 95% of the counter cyber budget is allocated to offensive measures. How does the panel deconflict these two? How will ML and AI be used in malware? And then this one here is, if you assure the US DOD is engaged daily in cyber warfare, how can AI improve our cyber offense and defense capabilities? And I just want to bring to the bear to this, the DARPA Cyber Challenge, which had computers fighting against computers for about a week, discovering vulnerabilities, repairing themselves, sometimes not repairing themselves to disclose a vulnerability that they wanted to attack. What do people want to talk about that? Oh boy.
I'll start out.
So, yes.
You know, it's definitely, that's a large gamut. I think with all AI application and anything, you know, that comes out defensively, eventually the attackers will abuse it. So, you know, with malware, I kind of think about, you know, 5 or 10 years ago when malware was, you know, being executed in virtualized environments. And then, you know, malware analysts were, you know, putting their malware in a virtualized environment and trying to do their behavioral and dynamic analysis to figure out, you know, what it did. Well, you know, malware's writers realized that, you know, that's what cyber defenders were doing, and it became aware, mm-hmm. and it would change its tactics. So I think as we move forward into this new age with AI, you know, they're just going to leverage AI to change tactics. And, you know, I think that will definitely be a challenge of how a lot of our, you know, cyber platforms and products begin to kind of attack, you know, this threshold. The other thing with, you know, our cyber products is, you know, we're very reliant on these products and platforms, but I don't think we have a really good understanding of how they use these AI processes. So at the end of the day, we kind of just trust them, you know, to do their thing and do detection, but we don't really have that granular ability to, you know, train the algorithm per se, so it can be a little bit more effective for our use case. Yeah. So, you know, something to worry about from an adversarial perspective.
So I was able to talk with David Brumley, who led the team that had Mayhem, which won the DARPA Cyber Challenge. And it was kind of interesting hearing some of the things they had to think about, because they did worry about if they patched, once they discovered a vulnerability, because all systems started with the same software, if they patched themselves, they were revealing a vulnerability that others would notice that they were patching and then fix it themselves. So they had to go through almost a game theory at computation two about, is it more value to attack it now that we've noticed it in other systems before we repair it in ourselves? Are we going to get more points that way? So interesting, that's another whole aspect of AI, not just the ML side, but this game theory kind of combinatrics type approach. He also always said that he still thought that there'll always be room for the uber hacker, the human who has almost intuition on this sometimes, both in fixing and finding vulnerabilities. But he said, we just don't have enough of those. And people-wise, China's got more of them than we got, because it's kind of a proportion of your population. So he said one of the good things about having AI cyber red teams or something is they can do a lot of the volume work. I mean, there was a report put out by my friend Bob Beeler at OT&E just Tuesday that we weren't doing sufficient cyber red teaming of US systems. And some of it is because we just don't have enough people. But at least at some level, you could use automated systems to do some red teaming and get rid of some of the vulnerabilities. Do you feel like we're at the stage yet where we could depend on these to do at least some level of red teaming? Oh boy.
They're all looking at me. I don't know. I've not tried to apply AI to the red teaming environment. I mm-hmm. think that moving forward and applying AI to those types of problem sets is a natural extension to where we are today. And you're right, there is definitely more work available than there are people to do it. That is for sure. I'd also agree wholeheartedly with Dave Brumley's assertion that you probably are still going to need humans in a loop somewhere to look at new problems we haven't seen before and still apply human creativity, which I think is one of the strengths of our nation anyway, is being creative. But we are going to have to start moving out and trying to figure out how do we automate a lot of that stuff, because you're right, you've got, 1.3 billion people in China. We're not going to win a one-to-one fight on a network with them.
To pile on there, there's a lesser known result from the Cyber Grand Challenge. Not only did they run the Cyber Grand Challenge where everything was fully automated, mm-hmm. they then took those systems and let them play in the human and machine capture the flag, and they ran Mayhem as mm-hmm. its own team, and then they had a hybrid team, and that hybrid team actually dominated the competition because the machine could do a lot of the harder, like deep search stuff, driven by the human guidance.
Yes.
That's also a result that follows with AlphaGo, the Google DeepMind technology, finally beat the Chinese grandmasters at the game of Go, which is a very complicated, massive search-based problem. And from that, these grandmasters have adopted new strategies for playing the game. They haven't really evolved their strategies in a very long time, but because of how the machine played, it played things they'd never seen before. They now have new strategies. So mm-hmm. there's an opportunity for sort of co-creativity with machines and humans working together. I also wanted to mention that at AAAI last week, there was an AI and cybersecurity workshop, and they released a problem set where they were applying this adversarial machine learning technology, specifically something called generative adversarial networks, where you take two two networks, two deep neural networks, and you pit them against each other. One is trying to detect, say, malware, mm-hmm. and the other is trying to create examples of malware that can't be detected. And they run these things against each other for very long periods of time. Those have dual use capabilities, right? And it is getting at a little bit of this sort of red team notion with automation.
I think there's absolutely early work going on right now, and especially in some smaller companies as well as in some larger companies that are thinking about how AI and ML can change mm-hmm. the equation around red team activities, if only to accelerate humans' behaviors and, right. and the expertise and maximize the value of an hour of human time. The unfortunate reality of the state of cyber is most of the time the complexity and elegance of AI and ML solutions aren't necessary in order for a human to rapidly penetrate many of our systems. And so there is a raising of tides that we need to do in some of these areas that I think are really vitally important. I also think that when you look at the overall application of these technologies, and the notion of adversaries using them, I think if you look introspectively, you'll see that adversaries are already using them. Mm-hmm. You start to look at the deep network, the deep learning activities that have been going on for image recognition and how they're being applied mm-hmm. to beat captures and authentication systems. And adversaries are already using these things.
And examination of social nets and getting info out of social nets.
This is happening today.
Yes.
And we need to get really comfortable very quickly with that is going to be a tool set that, again, as many in technology doesn't know right or wrong. It is about the dual use that we need to really start to think about when it comes to our posture from a cybersecurity perspective, but also how we're thinking about what the adversaries are capable of doing.
So I know in the last administration with Deputy Secretary of Defense Bob Work, he was really sort of fascinated in pushing the idea of Centaur systems, humans and machines working together. And he thought that might be a way around some of the trust issues that systems that were only machines might have, that use these two together to do a better job than you could do with either one of them. The machines can certainly respond to more volumes of data and faster responses, but the human has the creativity and that judgment factor that sometimes is hard to build into a machine. So with that, one thing you have to think about is how prepared are our forces to work in teams like that, machine-human teams. We do a lot of exercises for human teams, right? We go. We have red flags in Army training centers where soldiers, sailors, Marines go out and work as teams to kind of perfect their skills. I don't know that we have many exercises right now where machines and humans are working together to see how they can do that and test out these teaming concepts.
I think we have a long way to go there.
Yeah.
I think the concept behind teaming with a machine is far more complicated, and it depends upon the application. But going back to the car example, there is a natural distrust when we give something over to a machine that we've been doing for, in some cases, decades, individually. So that's something that we'll definitely have to work through, for sure.
Well, mentioned I'm a little bit older than some of the crowd. I remember when elevators had operators on them, And when they took the operators off, a lot of people were afraid, but you don't think anything of that now. So familiarity builds trust, A lot of monorails at airports and stuff don't have operators, and we feel okay about that. So we will gain trust in autonomous systems and AI systems as we get to use them. So, my gosh, we better start using them. Working with them.
Yeah, to emphasize this, Paul, we used to use this term digital native, right?
Yeah.
For kids that were growing up with the internet around them all the time. I heard this term recently, AI native. Our kids, right? I have four kids, 8 to 15. They're AI native now, right? Hey Siri, do something for me. Hey Alexa, do something for me. They're interacting with these AI systems all the time. Google is, a good friend of everyone that's studying and working on, homework assignments from school. So I think there is a generational thing where, 10, 15 years from now, new officers are going to be coming in, new enlisted folks are going to be coming in that are just used to these technologies being around them and wanting them to be around them.
I think that's absolutely true, but I think one of the things that we've got to start to think about today is with that blind trust, we need to think about how do we get to explicit trust and
yes.
reason to trust them. And I think that's going to take the notions that we've thought a lot about in traditional systems today of how do you have evidence and integrity and transparency and all of those characteristics that we think about in traditional systems. And how do we begin to either map them onto these systems or look for analogs that give us artifacts that would allow us, because what will happen with typical human behavior is, if as long as it keeps working, we'll keep going down that path, but without a real good reason to. And then at some point, there will be a challenging event that really fractures the trust in the overall systems that exist based off of them. And so I think now is the time for us to start to think about what characteristics would we be looking to engender in those systems, how would we challenge them, all of those fundamental questions. I think we actually have an opportunity that we didn't think about as nearly as much in the traditional systems today to start to do that in the AI ML space for tomorrow that would be really important for us to do.
So one question just came in that's a little bit of a follow-up to this, and I know addresses something that the OT&E community is trying to figure out. So how are we going to make sure that AI is explainable, that the decisions it makes is somewhat explainable, since they really aren't right now, so that we can enable this trust? And you got to remember that these decisions, that these AI systems often are a little bit non-deterministic. They might give a little bit different answer each time. And after they're in the field, depending on how we implement these systems, they may continue to learn. So they may give a different answer a week from now than they did today. So how are we going to find some ways to make this AI more explainable? We just don't want, 2001 HAL saying, no, I'm sorry, I can't trust you, you know?
Yeah, it's for anybody that hasn't watched the AlphaGo documentary on Netflix, I would encourage you to go do that, because it actually gets at this question of trust in the context of the event that was alluded to earlier. It's exactly the problem I described. Magic isn't useful. We need to think about how it is that we can build these things in. I think that we've got to really look at what role transparency is going to play, and knowing that the value of AI and ML comes from some combination of algorithms and data, it's going to create an interesting paradigm of what transparency is necessary for us to get some confidence.
Yeah.
So I don't know that there are great answers today.
Man, I got so many good questions here. We're probably not going to get to them all, but we'll keep this going. So here's a question that kind of plays on some of what you just said. So China seems to focus their AI and deep learning on societal reasons, where we're so concerned about legal protection and compliance, and we know the EU's got even more data type standards on top of them. Do you think our strict CIPA, HIPAA, FERPA standards are going to limit US in this cyber race, in this AI race? And what can we do about that?
I don't necessarily think it will, because I think when you get into some of the algorithms that are processing stuff, the output of an algorithm is not necessarily implying that the people that are reading that are having access to the protected data. They can do analysis on data and give a recommendation or give an output that doesn't require you to actually see, say, a medical record of an individual or a person. Looking at the outputs of an analysis of a data in aggregate, and there are ways to actually protect that and keep that segregated from people, I think, still in compliance with those things. Mm-hmm. That's something that we'll have to go through and think about as we design some of these larger data systems and AI ML solutions. But I don't think that's a technical roadblock per se. It's just mm-hmm. another requirement.
Okay. Anything else anybody would like to say on that?
Sure.
Okay.
So I think part of that is kind of the data sharing correlation. So I think what humans aren't great at is the correlation aspect. So you have all these disparate data sets, yet, you know, how do you make inferences across, you know, all these disparate data sets? So so when it comes down to, you know, from a threat actor, right? So, you know, you have a certain level of context, a certain level of confidence. And it kind of goes back to that, you know, the piece of the threat intelligence sharing. So, you know, we have AI, you know, at the edge, you know, figuring out certain indicators of compromise. You know, we're kind of pushing that back, but, you know, if I were to make a decision to say, hey, block this network, you know, what type of context does, you know, cyber analyst or operator have to make that decision? So, you know, we want to power AI to do that to some degree and trust it, but at the same time, you know, there could be drastic implications of that.
Mm-hmm. No doubt. Matt, earlier you mentioned adversarial AI. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about adversarial AI a little bit, because there's some questions coming in on that right now.
Okay.
Just in general, so tell them a little bit about what you're talking about and how it can manifest itself.
Sure. So the basic understanding of adversarial machine learning is you have a classifier system, a system that's trying to say, I see a dog in a picture, or something like that. That's an example of a classification problem. And what adversarial ML does, the sort of interesting part is, you can add some noise to a picture of a dog so that the classifier that maybe does 95% accuracy on detecting dogs The image will still look like a dog, but I've added some noise, and then the classifier will classify it as something else, or not have confidence that it's a dog anymore. This is the idea behind adversarial machine learning. To push on the dog example, there was there's a sort of canonical example of a classifier for detecting wolves versus dogs. Mm-hmm. And these things can go horribly wrong for all kinds of different reasons. These things can be very, very accurate, 95% accurate on all the test data that they have. And it turns out that in some of these situations, the reason you detect wolves versus dogs is because there's snow in the background of the wolves' pictures. This can be exploited by these adversarial techniques.
So sometimes we don't even know that there's bias in our data.
That's right.
It wasn't intentional to do that, right?
And these machine learning systems, to the point about explainability and interpretability, and I love this idea of transparency, we don't always know what they're keying on, what the features that they're focusing on when they're making the decisions that they're making. So that's a basic understanding of adversarial ML. Mm-hmm.
Are there ways to use adversarial ML techniques to make ML techniques more robust?
Yeah, so this idea I talked about earlier, generative adversarial networks. This is a well-known thing, very active in the research community, but people are using them. Google is prolific. There's a researcher at Google named Ian Goodfellow who sort of founded this field. So these are being used in production. They really strengthen your classification systems, right? You take an adversarial network which is trying to fool the detection system, and the detection system is using those failures to get better and better and better all the time. And so this sort of arms race of development of ML techniques is a powerful tool.
Yeah.
Just to add on to that, I think this highlights and that notion of adversarial use of this is actually in potentially in conflict with the idea of being more transparent about features and functions that are being used.
Yes.
In some ways, you could potentially be giving an adversary a roadmap of what features or functions to twiddle some bits on the data to indeed come up with a different result. So there's a lot of work to happen in this space where we've got to sort through some of these hard problems and how we're going to leverage the technologies.
And this is sort of an aside, but it's an interesting aside. These same sets of researchers have used these techniques to fool humans, right? So you're pretty good at recognizing a dog in a picture. They've actually used these adversarial machine learning techniques to generate pictures of dogs that you will think is a dog when it's really not. It's a cat or something else.
Interesting.
And one big application is this: if we want to use these to identify faces, facial features, maybe we want to attract people through airports, maybe we want to look at crowds and identify people that we want to watch, this could lead to those things being fooled and not being as dependable as we'd like. Here's a good one that kind of gets at something else. I mean, all of these are good ones. So we're depending more and more on open source. And there are a lot of open source AI ML tools, but do these represent a risk if we're using them? How do we know their provenance? And of course, they're open source to everybody, so how do we balance that?
So from a security platform standpoint, I think we hear the TensorFlows and some of the other algorithms, but I think from a product standpoint, a lot of our security vendors, we don't necessarily understand how they are using them. So when it comes back to the adversarial AI, I think there's a huge basis of understanding the kind of the life cycle and the maturity of how a vendor actually trains their data as a result. So I think there's definitely some more oversight that probably needs to occur in that space, but you know.
I think one thing that's sometimes misperceived by a lot of people is in AI, the AI algorithm is often a small part. It's the data and all the rest around that makes the system work, right?
Yeah, so there are all new, all new supply chain questions and concerns to be thought about. TensorFlow is an open source package. That's code, and we would hope that good software engineering practices were used to build that and test that. But really what you're reusing when you're building a machine learning system is the models that were built, right? Mm-hmm. So very common in the computer vision world is to reuse ImageNet, which is the Google network, right? It's not code, it's a model, it's a bunch of parameters. And there's a new program out of IARPA called TrojAI, Trojan AI, I think it's a play on, this is their evidence, not my evidence, where they believe there may be the ability to embed a Trojan in the model, not in the code, in the model, so that, you know, it still might work in 99% of the cases or 99.9% of the cases, but for one particular class, let's just say aircraft carriers in the ocean, you might not be able to detect them anymore. These are real concerns, and they open up a whole bunch of supply chain questions that I don't think everyone is thinking about right now.
So this is an interesting question that I don't think people have thought about, and we might not be able to answer. So when we talk about peer competitors in AI, ML, and even in cyber, we tend to think right away about Russia and China. What about other players? You know, a country like Estonia in particular is a really advanced information technology country. What do we know about what's going on in Estonia or in some other countries like that? Yeah, I thought this would be the case.
I mean, I can give one statistic that comes to mind. I talked about the paper submission statistics. The country with the highest acceptance rate was Israel. I don't know if that's good, bad, or otherwise, but just an observation. So there, I mean, the AI community is a rich international community. There's lots of research happening everywhere.
We've got several questions here that have various aspects about the philosophical issues and trust issues. So let me read a couple of them and then see what we can talk about. Are high-level philosophical concerns surrounding AI being addressed today? For example, one must assume that driverless vehicles will be based on, will sometimes have a loss of life. What happens when the vehicle determines that the least loss of life, it's gonna have some algorithm to determine this, is for the driver to be the one that loses their life? How are we gonna feel like that? Well, so we'll talk about that. Do you believe we have a trust versus risk model that is applicable to war fighters? Are machines, because machines are unemotional, does that mean that they will make decisions that don't show any empathy? You know, and sometimes empathy is important, but on the other hand, will they're maybe free from jealousy and rage too, right? Which is the other side of all that, right? So let's talk a little bit about trust, philosophical. How are we gonna gain trust in these systems? And the auto industry is a non-military one to talk about, but if we go to driverless cars, a driver today, you know, you start to skid and you sometimes make an instant decision, a decision just like that on what you're gonna do next. You know, whether you're gonna go into the next lane or off the road. If there's a crowd, where are you gonna go in the crowd? You know, or how are you gonna avoid most of the crowd but maybe hit someone else? How are we gonna help autonomous vehicles make those decisions? What's gonna be the value function for that?
I'm glad to say that there's a lot of thought going into
yes.
that conversation, specifically in organizations like IEEE and others,
yes.
where we're thinking about how do those trade-offs get made and establishing some norms to think about that aren't just applicable to any country. They're intended to be international standards and alignment around those standards. These are the challenges that will be and need to be answered. I don't know that the thing that we need to be doing, I believe, as organizations is making sure that we're actively participating in those activities because those are extraordinarily complex topics that are going to set the future of the next 20 years.
Yes.
Of what, you know, my daughter grows up in and how that world begins to evolve around her. I test drove a Tesla over the holidays and the first time that you let go of that wheel in traffic and have the system on, it is unnerving no matter how many YouTube videos you've watched of the system avoiding an accident that most certainly a human that was driving would have been involved in. And so I think there's a long way for us to come and as far as standards and reaching the agreements around the norms. I also believe that there's a lot of experience that we've got to begin to build in to this, and in many cases, I believe it will be a generational conversation mm-hmm. where the children of today will grow up in a different world with different expectations.
Well, a completely self-driving car might be the far extreme, but we're seeing the introduction of a lot of smaller assistive-type devices in autos that everybody's accepting quite well. I mean, there are devices to let you know if you're changing, if you're drifting out of a lane. There are devices to stop your car if you're backing up into a car or something like that. And most people kind of like those and trust those systems, right?
For sure.
Yeah, so.
I think the trust question, too, comes down to a lot of who's going to be responsible.
Yeah.
So going back to the driverless car question, you know, if you do run over someone on a bridge because a car calculated that as being the least loss of life, who's responsible for that death in that accident? Is it the car manufacturer who programmed
it? Well, that is a tough issue.
Is it the driver? What as a society?
Yeah, where's that user agreement that we signed that says no matter what, the software can't be sued, right?
Well, and don't underestimate as a part of that conversation, it's not just about ethics, it's about finance and who's liable yeah. in the context of those discussions.
About a year, I think it's a year and a half ago now, the German auto industry came out with about a 40-page document on what they thought were the ethics for self-driving cars should be. And it was kind of interesting, because like one thing is If you have to choose between hitting an 80-year-old and hitting a 5-year-old, what do you do? And they say all lives are equally important. But, So if you ever have a chance, you should look at this document. It's actually pretty interesting to look at that. Interesting question here. Do you see a use for AI and ML to change or accelerate one of the toughest problems we have, the defense acquisition cycle? You guys can see that one coming, right? What do you think?
That seems like a human interaction.
That is a pretty big human interaction.
The government guy.
Can I take the fifth?
Sure.
Sure. I think there's always opportunity in anything you're looking at where how can I make a decision better, faster, smarter? I think we'll have to, I don't have a specific case as to where I can apply that to our acquisitions today.
Yeah.
But I've got to imagine there are use cases there that those types of technologies can be applied to either quicker or evaluate numerous alternatives, make better decisions, evaluate more data.
Well, you know, one interesting thing in the defense acquisition cycle, because I've been around that for a while, is for 30 years we've had panel after panel make the same pretty much recommendations that we all agree on, but we somehow never seem to be able to implement. And I am a little hopeful that, at least in software-intensive systems, with the concepts that are sort of DevOps concepts, that maybe they'll help that. I mean, right now, some of these programs take 20 years or more to develop, and some of them we spend 3 to 5 years just in the requirements engineering phase. And yet, the DevOps world sort of admits up front that we don't know the requirements. And they will change during the development cycle. And so maybe those 5 years are not well spent right now. You know, maybe we should shorten them right off the bat. Furthermore, in a DevOps world, the idea is that we're delivering a minimal viable product and improving it. So at least we're getting something out there to the soldiers, sailors, airmen, and marines sooner,
yes.
As opposed to having to wait 20 years for this.
One of the other things, to pull it back to a cyber conversation, some component of that acquisition process mm-hmm. is risk assessment and how does it fit into larger systems. And AI ML isn't a magic answer to that, but I do believe it can play a role in helping accelerate the decisioning and efficacy and fidelity in many cases of those decisions so that they become more digitized. And candidly, in many cases, I see this in a lot of our commercial companies. Commercial customers, just the excitement that gets built around AI and ML becomes mm-hmm. a useful tool to help drive kind of systemic change. It may not be that AI and ML are the thing that is really what's needed. What's needed is something more basic from a digital perspective and a digitization perspective, but from a mentality perspective, from a leadership perspective, it's easy to go get money to go investigate an AI ML system to make the business more efficient or to make the process more efficient or to add margin mm-hmm. to the expense. So we shouldn't underestimate the adversarial technique of using AI and ML to overall build momentum in key spaces where obviously it has to play a role, but it
yes.
may be a component, again, back to the second point that I made, of the system that's needed to be solved for.
Yes.
So I think the answer to the mm-hmm. Will AI be able to help with the acquisition cycle is yes.
Mm-hmm.
But there's also the flip side of that. As we build systems that have more AI and machine learning in them, acquisition is necessarily going to have to change, right?
Yes.
Technology is moving so fast, and in particular AI and ML is moving so fast. You can't write requirements and then get your system 5 years later or 10 years later. You need to be in the months cycle because these technologies are just changing and adapting so quickly.
Yeah, I think as we move forward, I mean, we're going to see very unique ways to help monetize those algorithms.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, you know, you say you buy a Tesla today, you know, you get this level of, you know, an algorithm to help whatever. But of course, you know, there's that external feature set. So somewhere you'll look, you know, for a cyber perspective, you look at, hey, I want to subscribe to this threat intelligence feed or this feed.
Yes.
It's going to cost, you know, X amount of money. Well, you know, maybe we want to subscribe to new, unique algorithms that help, you know, defend our posture.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
And is it on demand? Is it, you know, pay once?
Yes.
You know, by the hour?
Okay, there's a couple of questions here that kind of clump together a little bit. Involved with, like, the first one has got the genesis in it. There's been a lot of advancement in reinforcement learning with applications, things like deep Q learning. Most of these applications have always been demonstrated on games. How do we move past the games into useful applications of reinforcement learning, in specifically in cybersecurity. And we have a similar question here. How can DoD Air Force move forward AI when there's so many issues around it? How do we really get it in practice now?
I'll take the first one. Mm-hmm. So reinforcement learning, yes, you're right. Most of what's been done, most of what's been in the press is games. Just recently, I think DeepMind beat a human team in StarCraft, which is an amazingly complex game. I read a little bit about how the machines cheated a little bit in that game. If anyone's interested afterwards, I can tell you about that. And OpenAI, which is a nonprofit AI research group, has been doing a ton of work in reinforcement learning on games. There's also transfer of reinforcement learning in simulation to robot platforms. So there are mechanisms or examples of taking it from simulation or gaming environments and moving that control algorithm to the real world. So I think there's a lot of promise here, and a lot of the self-driving cars are using reinforcement learning as well. Mm-hmm. So that's the first one.
Okay, anybody got anything more on that?
Yeah, so for the DoD and Air Force adoption, I would say it's important to look at it from a phased implementation, right? You're not just gonna put AI in, you know, your environment and it's gonna fix all the problems. You know, you need to look at very narrow use cases. And really, I think you wanna quantify the metrics. So, you know, if I deploy AI, you know, at the endpoint, does it reduce, you know, my number of threats?
Yeah.
Can I showcase how quick I can respond to these events? Is it reducing my spend in some of the areas of, you know, what I spend, you know, for my entire cyber ecosystem?
Yeah.
So there's ways to quantify it.
Well, and can this be more predictive, where you actually eliminate the threats before they're realized, right? Yeah. Well, unfortunately, I got the master question here. It actually wasn't a question. It says, last question, sir. So we have to go to that one. And here's a good one. And boy, this could be an hour worth of discussion here. How will we defend against AI and ML being used against us? That's a big question. And I'll let these people think a little bit. I was lucky to be the chair of the Defense Science Board's autonomy study a few years ago. And one of the key things we brought up in there is, are we prepared, you know, to take the onslaught of autonomous systems? And because of different ethics, we may see autonomous systems used against us before we're willing to use them ourselves. And so that's kind of the heart of this question. And I don't know that we have a great answer for that, but I know there are programs looking for counter-autonomy, counter-AI now. We might not be able to talk about them a lot here, but maybe people have some ideas about that. And does CyberWorks do anything like that?
No, we're not working in that space. But I do think that it comes back to the arms race question. I think we have the same kind of paradigm now, is we're trying to improve security and improve attacking and improve security and improve attacking. It's, you know, who's ahead of who. I think you'll see the same thing in AI and counter AI, is we'll develop new deep learning algorithms and an adversary may come up with a way to counter those and vice versa. Mm-hmm. It's really about having your investment in the right place and getting back to some of the returns that Matt too was talking about. And trying to be more creative and more adaptable to the adversary. I think my big concern there is some of the societal differences and risks that some nations are probably willing to take that we are
ethics,
more reluctant
right?
to take.
Yes, yes.
So I do have some concern in that area, how it'll play out, to be determined.
Yeah, I think of some of the Star Wars movies with Attack of the Clones, and man, there were a lot of those clones.
I was thinking more Battlestar Galactica.
Yes, 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 yes.
But when you think about that, I go back to the idea that AI is a part of that system. And so thinking about the system and its capabilities and how AI enables it to do something new, I think is a useful way to approach that problem. If you just worry about the foundational bits of AI and the models and the algorithms and the data, it becomes a really intractable problem to some level, but focusing on how those systems may manifest themselves, I think will provide some opportunities of focus in key areas.
Yeah. Well, there was great discussions, and we had so many questions that we didn't even get to. This seems to be a topic on people's minds right now. Perhaps this should be a reprise panel next year at this conference or something like that. With that, let me thank everybody. These panelists did a great job. They kind of got into it after a while, bonded well, and I think gave us a nice discussion. So please help me thank this panel.
Sir, thank you so much.
Pleasure. Thank you so much.
Be safe flying.
Yeah. You bet.
to go ahead and ask everyone to please stay in your seats for a presentation. First off, I want to thank Dr. Nielsen and his panel again for taking time to come out and have the discussions with us. Very lively discussion. Thanks for the participation from the audience. I do want to take another moment to correct my previous announcement of Cadet Third Class Addison Whitney, not Whitney Addison. Grew up in South Louisiana, sometimes I'm backwards. So, hope you guys got a chance to get out to the floor and see the Capture the Flag event. At this point, while we're kind of pulling some of the stage stuff back, I'd like to invite Mr. Ryan Roberts from Deloitte to come up here and present the winners of that particular event. So stand by.
Hey, thanks a lot. What a great event, and what a great opportunity to be here. While these wonderful future cyber warriors are walking up, I thought I'd sort of introduce you to what we've been doing for the last 3 years. It started with a conversation with Bob Wright about how do we start bringing in some of our young cyber warriors, encouraging them, starting to sort of incubate them, and get an opportunity to nurture them as part of the Rocky Mountain Cyber Symposium. And of course, for me, it was about, I need to hire a bunch of guys, Bob, and girls that are really good at cyber, and I need help trying to find them. So we sort of got together and we built this Capture the Flag event. And we wanted it to be about bringing the students in, giving them an opportunity to sort of show off what they do, giving them an opportunity to expose them to what we're seeing in the marketplace. And I just couldn't be prouder of this group up here. I really am proud of them, and I think it's great to see young people have a passion for such a big problem. So I'd like to start by giving them a round of applause for that. So this year we had 5 schools, in no particular order, because I don't want to give away the winners here. The University of Colorado, Colorado Springs, Team UC Lions. Give them a round. Team Router Rooters from Pikes Peak Community College. Team Delagran from this university called the Air Force Academy. Team Autolock, all the way from Brigham Young University. And lastly, CTU from Colorado Tech. So before we pass the official guide on, awarding the winner of the CTF this year, I wanted to explain to anybody who doesn't sort of understand what a CTF is. So if you played Capture the Flag when you were a kid, it's exactly that, just in the cyber domain. So we sit them in front of a virtualized environment, and we give each team the same set of challenges that they can get after in whatever order they want. And it's a series of puzzles and challenges across all of the major categories in which you would expect from a cyber perspective. So things like cryptologic challenges, things like hacking websites, things like taking advantage of backdoors. It really encourages them to think outside the box, right? Our adversaries are doing that, just that. They are looking at a maze and saying, I'm not gonna follow the walls of this maze, I'm just gonna go right through them, right? They're thinking about this problem differently, and that's what the CTF tries to encourage. So each of these teams should really be applauded for not only their technical skills, but really there's a creative thinking component, which is most important for us as we look at how to defend our nation from the adversaries of today and the future. So thank you very much to them for their outstanding work. All right, so now it's the moment we've all been waiting for. The winners here today, the number one team will get presented a guide on, which I think is here. Thank you, Vanessa. and 2 and 3 will also get some fun prizes to take home. So number three, I'm proud to say the winner, or number three, placed number three in our CTF competition from the University of Colorado, Colorado Springs, the UC Lions. In second place, Team Otto Lock from Brigham Young University. And our 2019 Rocky Mountain Cyber Symposium CTF champions, Team Delegram from the Air Force Academy. Thank you very much for giving us the time. We're going to do a photo op and then we'll get out of your hair. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, a couple quick remarks. Please join us for our second round of Tech Talks over in Colorado Hall beginning at 1545. The exhibit hall does close today at 1700. And we will see you back here tomorrow morning starting at 0715 for our Continental Breakfast sponsored by Valdez in the exhibit hall. And then back here for our opening remarks at 8:15. Be safe and have a good night. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.